In hell, there is an undying rage against God and oneself. Hell is a horrific place. It is a real place. It is a tormenting place, not a torturous place. The torture comes through the torment, but it is not a torture in the sense where people are just pitchforks and knives and they're going through torture racks and all that. That is not at all biblical. But it is a tormenting place. And in hell, everyone who goes to hell will forever have a rage against God and oneself. They will understand the simplicity of the cross of Jesus Christ and what he did, and they will have a rage against God about how easy it was to come to know him, and they will have a rage against themselves for not heeding or taking the opportunities of God sending certain people their way across their path to share their gospel, to share the gospel, and then for those, for they themselves to not accept it or to not act on it. And when we believe Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and we repent of our sins, we become born again. We are saved from our sin, from hell, the lake of fire, and damnation. And we are brought into eternal life, into a way by which we can grow in fellowship with God. Our relationship with the Heavenly Father deepens, and we begin to understand what true life is. But those in hell will forever have an undying rage against God and oneself. And many people think, how can hell be eternal? That's just terrible. Why does God have to be that way? Because God is a just God and he is a holy God. And he will not let sin go unexcused. But he did, however, send his son out of love to demonstrate his own love that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And he has provided the way of salvation that where we can be saved from that, but we need to be willing to accept it and to repent of our sins in order to enter into all that Christ has done for us. Because God didn't need to send his son at all, but he did it out of love because he sent his son not to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And so that is why there is always an undying rage against God and oneself. People think, how can it go on eternal? How can God allow that? People think that for some reason, once you're in hell, that sin just doesn't continue anymore. Sin continues to happen. Selfishness continues to ramp up. Rage and blasphemy against God continues to go on and on and on. And sin compounds sin compounds sin. And there's forever going to be a anger and a hatred and a rage against God and oneself. And hell is a tormenting place. It is a place where eventually you'll be cast into the lake of fire. Lucifer, fallen angels, transgressors, the wicked, the ungodly will be tormented day and night forever and ever. It's a place where darkness can be felt. It's a place where the mind will continually be warped from the eternity in hell, and it will go back into the missed opportunities in this life of hearing about Jesus, but seeing all the missed opportunities and then going, being warped back into hell. That's what the where the worm dieth not, as Isaiah talks about in its last chapter. That's what it is referring to. It is a place of solitude where there is no communication with anyone, and the only noise that one may ever hear is the screams of those elsewhere in hell. But other than that, if there even is the possibility of hearing such, that's what it will be. But other than that, it's complete solitude of living within the confines and not being able to see or experience anything that is good or love, to live with oneself, the self-absorption of oneself forever and ever. It's going to be a place where there is no rest. People will not be able to sleep or to go to rest. They will try to die. They will beg for death, but death will flee from them. That is what hell in the lake of fire is, and that is going to happen perpetually. And that is why there is going to be an undying rage, because people will see the missed opportunity they had here in this life. They will continually hate God as they did in this life. They will not want to bend or change from their ways, and they will continue to dig themselves deeper into the eternal abyss by which they will never get out of. And they will remember us who are the saints in heaven. They will remember the times we came and shared Jesus with them, and they said no. And that is why there is an undying rage against God and oneself in hell, And this truth needs to be known, and we need to allow it to motivate us to share the love of God with all, to share truth and love with all, in order that many may escape hell on that final day. Because wide is the gate that leads to destruction, but narrow is the way that leads to eternal life, and few there will be who find it. And we need to ask that the Holy Spirit would evangelize through us and would disciple others through us, in order that others may not only enter into the faith, but grow in the faith, deepen in the fellowship with God, and then be led by the Holy Spirit and feel confident enough to go out and share the good news. Because God desires to save all. He does not desire to damn anyone. He desires mercy and not wrath. He wants none to perish, but all to come to repentance. But we ourselves need to allow the Holy Spirit to guide us as vessels to speak truth, to speak God's word, and to show men that salvation can only occur by grace through faith in what Christ has done, and is not by good works of what we've done, lest we would boast. And we need to show them that Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, and may all come to know him, to come to the knowledge of him, and to come through true belief and true genuine repentance, in order that they may begin their new walk with God and be saved from the horrors and the torment of what is to come, which we know to be the final destruction of man forever and ever in eternity in hell in the lake of fire.